Hi, I'm Christa, and today I'm going to be talking about gradient boosting. I'm going to be starting off talking about a general overview of ensemble methods, and then go into a brief explanation of gradient boosting, and then I'm going to be showing you how to do gradient boosting in SAS. So let's get started. So first, I'm going to start off with a simple example using something that most people in machine learning are familiar with, and that's just using a single model. So you start off, you have your data, you take your samples, and then you pass it into your model, and then you get your prediction. So if you're looking to improve your performance and you're using a single model, you can use ensemble methods. So two main types of ensemble methods is bagging and boosting. So for bagging, you're using parallel training. So you have multiple independent models that you're training to try and capture variance in your data. Whereas in boosting, you're using sequential training. So in this case, you have one model and you're trying to improve upon its errors to improve your performance. So I'm going to give a really simple overview using people as an example. So on the left, you have bagging and you start off with your one model. So this is represented by the person. And so if you're going to use the bagging method and you're trying to improve it that way, all you're doing is adding more people to the scenario. So you're trying to add multiple models to try and capture that variance. So on the right, you have boosting. And so this is where you are starting off with a weak learner and you're trying to improve upon the errors over time. So it's kind of like your model's maturing over time and growing up. So this is how this is achieving its performance improvements. So now I'm going to use the same like people example, except give something more specific. So here you have an example, and this is just like a little kid. So you have this kid, and you're going to ask them, how many continents are there? So if this is a kid, maybe they're 5 years old, they might say something like 27. They have no idea. And if you were trying to use the bagging method, you might just be adding more kids to the scenario. So is this really going to improve the results? Are they really going to provide a better answer? And the case is probably not. So you might have more kids are going to give more of like a random answer. So they might say stuff like 42, 9. Adding more children is probably just not going to help in this scenario. So if you have data that doesn't have high variance and might have like it has low variance and like a high bias, you might be able to learn how those errors are being made and be able to improve upon the model that way. So we have this weak learner that we're going to use on this, and you're going to say how many continents. And at first, they're going to give you, you know, a random answer. So you might say something like 200. And then you have the kid growing up and maturing, and they're learning more things, and they're learning from their mistakes. And now they're going to say something like 21. And then we keep training and keep learning from the errors. And now finally we have an improved model who gives us a better answer. So now I'm going to move on to the actual representation of bagging and boosting real quick. So you start off with your original data. And then you take your random samples from it. And then you do your first model. So all of these methods are going to start off this kind of similar way. But the important difference is here, so you have your additional models that you're using. You can see that the arrows show they're all independently learning. So they're all taking their own random sample, and they're learning using their own model. And then you take all of the prediction results from these models and do some sort of voting. So there's multiple methods you could use to kind of get what the overall answer is. So for classification, you might just choose a majority vote. Whereas if you're doing regression, you might just take the average of the responses for the models for your result. So for boosting, you know, you see we start off in a very similar way. So we have the original data, we have our random sampling, and we're sending it into our model. However, this is where the distinction is. So here, this is just an example of a boosting method. You might have your model, and now you're going to use that to determine where it was making its mistakes. And you use those observations that you made mistakes on to weight them so that in your next model that you get, they're going to have a more a higher likelihood of receiving that in their sample. So it's no longer a random sampling anymore. You're trying to find those observations that you're doing worse on and try and learn more about them. So you do this over and over until you have a good representation of what your data actually is like. and you take all of these models and do a weighted voting. So as you're doing this over time, you're going to keep track of which models are performing the best and the worst, and those models get either, if they're doing well, they'll get more of a say. If they're doing worse, they get less of a say. So this is just an example of boosting. And like in AttaBoost, this model will actually look at how well the model is performing, and if they're not doing well at all, they might just drop them. So it'll train them, test it, and drop it. If they're doing well enough, then they get in the actual weighted voting portion. So for the topic of today's video, I'm going to show now gradient boosting. So gradient boosting is just another form of boosting. You start off the same way as the previous methods. You have your original data, your random sample, and you send it to the first model. Except now, after you have this and you have the predictions from that first model, you're going to take the loss between the targeted value and the predicted value and try and learn maybe if there's any patterns in those errors. So if you can find patterns in the residuals and model that, then you can use that to improve upon your model. So you're focusing solely on the areas in which you're not performing very well. So if you see, now we're going to train a model on this residual, and you take the residuals from that model and you train that again. And so you're trying to reach a threshold of where your residuals are very close to zero. So you're having a very low error rate between your predicted and target variables. And so this just happens over time. And you want to ensure when you're doing this that you're not going to a point of overfitting your model, because that can be an issue with gradient boosting. And so once you have all of your training done and you've either reached the cutoff or decided to stop due to overfitting, you take a sum of these models' predictions. So this is different than the previous methods where we're using some sort of voting method. Here, because the first model is kind of giving us prediction and the rest of them are predictions of the errors, what this is trying to do is take that initial prediction and modify it based on what we learn from those errors. So you're going to take those and add them together. So if it thinks it's off by a little bit, when you do that addition, then it fixes it. All right, so now I'm going to be moving over to Model Studio to show you how gradient boosting is done in there. All right, so now I'm in Model Studio. I have my gradient boosting example already ready, and I'm using the HMEQ dataset. So now that the project is loaded up, so it takes us to the data tab initially, you can see the variables that we're using, and you can see that bad is set to the target. So in the links below, there'll be a link to this data set, and also you can look up what the individual variables mean. But I'm just going to move right into how to do gradient boosting using this. So this is a binary target, so we're just looking to predict whether or not if the answer is 1 or 0. So to start off, I'm going to go to the supervised learning tab and drag over a gradient boosting node. All right, so here it gives us a brief description of the gradient boosting model. We can see the number of trees that we have. It starts off as a default of 100. You have your learning rate, your L1 regularization rate, and you also have the option to change the tree splitting option. So you can change the number of branches, the maximum depth, the minimum leaf size. So you have a variety of options. And then, of course, instead of just manually changing these variables, you also have the option to perform auto-tuning if you want to. I'm also going to show you real quick if you're interested in the type of gradient boosting that SAS is doing. So there's this website that you can go to. If you look up SAS Viya gradient boosting, you'll be brought to here, which will just point you to the grad boost procedure. So this is the basis for the gradient boosting node, and if you want to learn more details about that, or if you're interested in using it in a SAS code node, then you can do so. And modify variables that way. Okay, so now I'm going to go back to the example that I was showing, and I'm going to run it. Okay, so the pipeline has successfully completed. I'm going to go ahead and open the results for the gradient boosting node. You could open the model comparison tab, but I don't have any other nodes to compare it to right now, so I'm just opening these results. So initially, when you open up the gradient boosting result, you'll see that it shows an error plot with average squared error, and it also shows the variable importance. So you can look at this and see what variables were most important to your model, but you can also look here and change this to the misclassification rate. So you can see that as the number of trees were added, especially in the beginning, we had better and better misclassification rates over time. I'm gonna expand this so we can see the legend real quick. So here we can see the training as the training continues to get better. We're not really noticing much improvement over time with the validation and test sets. So this might be a case in which we want to use less trees just in case we're overfitting around in this area where we're no longer seeing much improvement. But next I'm going to add two other nodes. So let's see here. So I'm going to drag over a forest node. So forest is a bagging method, so we can look at that to compare it to. And I'm also going to compare it to just a regular single model decision tree. All right, so I have these nodes loaded. One thing is that the default options for these individual models are a little different. And just to kind of make it a little more similar before I run it, I'm going to change some of the tree splitting options just so the trees are kind of similar shapes, just so it provides a little bit better of a comparison, although some other things might be different, so keep that in mind. So here for the gradient boosting node, we have a maximum depth of 4. And I know that another one of these has 10, so I'm just gonna go ahead and change this to 10 also. So I'm gonna go over to the forest node and look at its options. So here it's also using 100 trees. And then here we have a maximum depth for its trees being 20. So I'm going to go ahead and change that to be 10 also. And then I'm going to check decision tree real quick. And so this maximum depth is 10. So now all of them are around the same shape of tree. There might be a little difference in some of the methods that it's using, but for the most part, these are kind of similar. So we can compare the boosting method compared to the bagging method compared to the single model. So I'm going to run this real quick. Okay, so now the pipeline has successfully finished. I'm going to go ahead and click on the model comparison node and open the results. So for this example, the gradient boosting node did turn out to be the best method. You can see that its misclassification rate is the lowest, followed by the decision tree, and then lastly the forest. So for this case, adding more trees wasn't enough. We actually needed to look at the individual errors that we had. And so even though we have the decision tree, which is the single model, and the forest, which is using multiple decision trees, this difference might just be due to individual options with inside these nodes that are causing it to be a little different. But you can go and you can play around with all of these options. You can perform auto-tuning to improve your model. And you can try boosting and bagging to see if any of those have a good effect. All right, so I hope you learned a thing or two about gradient boosting. If you want any of the links that I talked about or any additional resources, you can check out the description below. You can also feel free to leave any sort of comments or questions about the video. And if you did like this video and you want more tips like this, you can subscribe to the channel. And thanks for watching.